Glory be to God. There's nothing in this world like a mother's love. Have you ever seen a mother hold her baby in her hand and say, "What a ugly pygmy"?
No, sir.
What a ugly baby.
No, sir.
There is nothing in this world like a mother's love. Happy Mother's Day, mothers. Happy Mother's Day to my favorite woman, my wife. There are two other favorite women that are not here with me today. That's my mother and my mother-in-law. As we pay tribute to mothers on this Mother's Day, I want to challenge your thinking by this profound statement. Not all female who give birth to a child or children are mothers in the truest sense.
Amen.
Not all female who give birth to a child or children are mothers in the truest sense. A few weeks ago, a young woman gave birth to a child, then abandoned it by placing it in the dumpster. What would let a female do such a horrible thing to an innocent child? Not all female who give birth to a child or children are mothers in the truest sense. Let your imagination run wild, or let it go further. But as you are thinking, I will ask you another question. What kind of mother are you?
Amen.
What kind of mother are you? Not all female who give birth to a child or children are mothers in the truest sense. Today's topic comes in the form of a question. What kind of mother are you?
Amen.
We will look at some mothers in the Bible, and you can determine the one to whom you identify. The main text for today is found in 1 Kings 3, verses 16 to 28. And in this text, we'll see the tale of two mothers and the character that was displayed. 1 Kings 3, 16 to 28. Now, two women who were harlots came to the king and stood before him. And one woman said, "Oh my lord, this woman and I dwell in the same house, and I gave birth while she was in the house. Then it happened the third day after I've given birth that this woman also gave birth, and we were together. No one was with us in the house except the two of us in the house." Verse 19. And this woman's son died in the night because she lay on him. So she arose in the middle of the night and took my son from my side while your maidservant slept, and laid him in her bosom, and laid her dead child in my bosom. And when I rose in the morning to nurse my son, there he was dead. But when I had examined him in the morning, indeed, he was not my son whom I had born. Then the other woman said, "No, but the living one is my son, and the dead one is your son." And the first woman said, "No, but the dead one is your son, and the living one is my son." Thus they spoke before the king. Verse 23, and the king said, "The one says, 'This is my son who lives,' and your son is a dead one. And the other says, 'No, but your son is a dead one, and my son is a living one.' Then the king said, 'Bring me a sword.' So they brought a sword before the king, and the king said, 'Divide the living child in two, and give half to the one and half to the other.' Then the woman whose son was living spoke to the king, for she yearned with compassion for the son, her son. And she said, 'Oh my Lord, give her the living child, and by no means kill him.' But the other said, 'Let him be neither mine nor yours, but divide him.' So the king answered and said, 'Give the first woman the living child, and by no means kill him. She is his mother.'" We trust the Lord to have his blessing upon his, the reading of his word. Amen. Father, we thank you. The word says, "Can a mother tender care cease to all the child she bear? And even if that love ceases, your love will remain steadfast." As I come to share your word, I am weak, but you are strong. You're the potter, I'm the clay. You're the voice, I'm just the instrument. Anoint me from the crown of my head to the sole of my feet, and enable me by your spirit to bring forth your word. May I be decreased, and may Christ be increased. May you bless your words to our heart and glorify your name. We ask these things in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. What kind of mother are you? Pastor, how dare you question my mother? Do you know where I've been? Do you know what I've been through, what I'm going through? You don't know, Pastor, but God knows. I may not know where you've been. I may not know where you're going through, what you're going through, because each heart bears its own sorrow. But as we gather here today, we have evidences of mothers throughout our lives. Maybe an aunt, a stepmother, a godmother, our own mother, a grandmother, the church mother, somebody who has stood in that gap or stood for us as a mother. And the question comes, what kind of mother are you? I'm not questioning your motherhood. I'm just asking you to think deep, to reflect, and to see who you are in the eyes of God, and who you are in the eyes of your children, and who you are in the eyes of the world. Because you may think you're a bad mom, and indeed you're a good mom. And you may think that you're a perfect mom, but you are an imperfect mom. So when I ask the question, what kind of mother are you? I'm not trespassing on your territory. I just want you to think. We see the tale of two moms in the story. And the true mother, hearts yearn for her child. She knows the pain. She knows the agony. She knows the circumstances. But one other mother could care less. After all, her child was dead. The mothers whose child died did not exhibit a caring or compassionate heart as a true mother would. It seems as if she was more concerned about her sleep than the welfare of her child. Upon realizing that she smothered her child, she should be grieving and mourning over its death. Instead of fabricating a deceptive scheme to steal the other mom's child, whom she didn't love or care for anyway, as is evidenced in 1 Kings 3:26, when she wanted that child dead, split him in two, give her a half, and give me the other half. What good is half of a dead child to a mother? Let it be neither be mine nor thine. Divide it. She wanted King Solomon to cut the baby in two. Not all female who give birth to a child or children are mothers in the truest sense. The mother to whom the child belonged would rather relinquish her motherly right and give up that child to the other woman rather than seek kill. Isaiah 49:15-16 states, can a woman forget her suckling child that she should not have compassion on the son of her womb? Yes! They may forget, yet I will not forget you, says the Lord. It was David said, when my mother and my father forsake me, then the Lord will lift me up. There are many stories of mothers who are unable to take care or provide for their child or children. And they gave them up for adoption, so they could have a better life than they could give. A true mother does not only care for her children, but have compassion for other mothers' children. Amen. This woman lacked compassion. If it was her child, what use would half of a dead child be to her? If I can't have it, then you won't have it either. We have to understand children live what they learn. They observe us every day. And sometimes we teach them indirectly to be careless in our speech, in their speech and in their action or attitude. We can teach them compassion to care for others or do to others as unlike others do to them. Or we can teach them to be insensitive to the pain, the suffering, the hurt, or the misfortune of others. After all, they cause it upon themselves. So why should I care? A mother, true mother, doesn't only care for her children, but have compassion for other mothers' children. And love others, people's children, not only her own. I have seen in a neonatal intensive care unit, Joseph was a baby. Some mothers could not produce milk for their infants. And other mothers volunteer their milk. Other times, when Joseph was in the neonatal intensive care unit, and the nurse asked my wife's permission to use the remainder of an expensive medication that he was getting to be available to another baby who needed it. The parents could not afford it. But expensive. This was good medicine. Still in the vial. They had normal. Use a syringe and take out the portion that is needed. And would discard the other. But here is a nurse. She may not have had a child, or she may have children, but she placed herself in the position of those child who were in need. Yes, Joseph had the medication he needed. That child didn't. Can you give us permission to give that other child so he could live? Mm-hmm. My wife did not hesitate. And while our child was there being taken care of, his fortune was a fortune to another child. While we're there in the neonatal intensive care unit, we see mothers. Little infants in those units, chest open. Lungs exposed, barely holding on to life. And while we're there caring for little 2.5-pound baby Joseph, our thoughts, my wife's thought, were on other mothers' children. What am I saying? Jesus loved the little children. All the children of the world, red and yellow, black or white, they are precious in His sight. Jesus loved the little children of the world. And if Jesus loved them and said, allow the little children to come unto me, no mother's compassion or bowels can be turned away from another child who she did not give birth to. I have seen females who have never given birth to a child adopt and embrace a child as if that child came from her very womb. As a child from a big family, I saw my mother, grandmother, and a beloved aunt practice before our very eyes, feeding, clothing, helping, and putting up other mothers' children. We cannot be indifferent to other people's children. They are our own. And a mother's heart goes out not only to her child, our children. but she concerned about the welfare of other mothers' children. A mother is not only a female who gives birth to a child or children, but a female with the capacity and quality of character, of a heart of compassion that cares for other people's mothers' children, not only their own. A lamentable fact in many sections of our society today is that too many unwed and immature girls are becoming mothers. They themselves need to be mothered and raised. And they are shouldering the responsibility of trying to raise children they can hardly raise. Children. Raising children. This leads to breakdown of home. This leads to breakdown of family life. And further leads to breakdown to the destruction. Dysfunction in society. We need to pray for our girls and young women and help to prepare them for the women and mothers of tomorrow. Amen. What kind of mother are you? It's not for me to say, it's for you to look deep down within your heart and reflect on who you are as a mother. In Genesis 16 and 21, chapter 21, 9 to 21, the Genesis 16, and in Genesis chapter 21, 19 to 21, we see a distraught mother, Hagar. I'm going to read it, because there may be some mothers were going through some agony. You feel cornered. You feel abandoned. You feel rejected. Genesis 21, 9 to 21. You may feel as if the world has forgotten you. And you are being passed over, looked over. This surrounds a situation where Hagar was given permission by Sarah to go to bed with Abraham. And eventually Ishmael came. And in chapter 21, 9 to 21, and Sarah saw the son of Hagar, the Egyptian, whom she had borne to Abraham, scoffing. Therefore she said to Abraham, cast out this bondwoman and her son, for the son of this bondwoman shall not be with my son, namely with Isaac. And the matter was very displeasing in Abraham's sight, because of his son. But God said to Abraham, do not let it be displeasing in your sight because of the lad or because of your bondwoman. Whatever Sarah has said to you, listen to her voice, for in Isaac your seed shall be called. Yet I will also make a nation of the son of the bondwoman, because he is your seed. So Abraham rose early in the morning and took bread and a skin of water, and putting it on her shoulder, he gave it and the boy to Hagar and sent her away. Then she departed and wandered in the wilderness of Beersheba. And the water in the skin was used up. And she placed the boy under one of the shrubs. Then she went and sat down across from him at a distance. her about to bow shut, for she said to herself, let me not see the death of the boy. So she sat opposite him and lifted up her voice and wept. And God heard the voice of the lad. Then the angel of the Lord called to Hagar out of heaven and said to her, what ails you, Hagar? Fear not. For God has heard the voice of the lad where he is. Arise, lift up the lad. Hold him with your hand, for I will make him a great nation. Then God opened her eyes, and she saw a well of water. And she went and filled the skin with water and gave the lad a drink. So God was with the lad, and he grew and dwelt in the wilderness and became an archer. He dwelt in the wilderness of Paran, and his mother took a wife for him from the land of Egypt. There are lessons in the Bible that we can learn from. There's a twist to a story. I know each mother loves their children. And in our society where we have stepmom and stepdad, we have to exercise care how we treat children. The word of God said when little baby Ishmael was out there thirsty, crying, God heard his voice. You see, the mother was distraught. She was weeping. Yes, God heard her, but God heard Ishmael, the lad's voice. And we need to be careful what we do to children. We can't seem to fry children in the pot. In the fact of a stepdad or a stepmom or somebody else. This lad, God heard him crying. And God does not forsake the orphan. He said he'd be a father to the widow, a husband to the widow, and a father to the orphan. So we need to be careful how we treat children, whether they're our own or not. Because Jesus said the angels in heaven are watching. Yes. So God saw this distraught woman. There may be many distraught women here today. Or in our society. Whatever they are going through, we need to exercise compassion. Woman to woman. Mother to mother. I said, there goes I, but for the grace of God.
Amen.
And here Hagar was sent out in the desert with her child. While your child is fed and clothed, some other mother's child is naked and cold and hungry. While your child has a roof over its head, some other mother's child is living under a bridge. We can't be sensitive to the pains of fellow humanity, because if the tide would turn, we'd want them to help us if they were in our position. Don't treat kids badly because you and their mother are parents or have a conflict. As mothers, you need not only care about your own, but must have the capacity to love other mothers' children.
Amen.
You must not only offer counsel and guidance to your children, but can take the initiative to guide and counsel other mothers' children. We cannot just be concerned with our children. While our children are clothed, there are others who are naked. While ours are fed, there are others who go hungry. While others are, ours are warm and comfortable, there are others who are cold and uncomfortable.
Yes.
Motherhood is not just a name given to a female who give birth to a child or children, but a quality of character, of care and compassion for children, whether they are our own or not.
Amen.
The least we can do is to help one. Each mother reach out to another mother's child or children. You may not be able to help everyone, but by God, you can help someone.
Amen.
In Genesis 27, we see a deceptive mother, Rebecca, who colluded with Jacob to rob Esau of his birthright. Mothers, be careful how you relate to each of your children. It can cause bad blood and hatred among them. I've seen in many families bad blood. Because mothers or father did not take time out. They're trying to show preference and put up one and bring down another. And sometimes the kid grow up with resentment and an inferiority complex because they are better off than me. I am nobody. I'm the black sheep of the family. We need to understand that when physical hurt heals with time, emotional hurt and psychological hurt goes on for years. In Kings, 1 Kings 3, 16 to 28, we see that this generous mother, that's in our story. It was not her baby. It was the other mother's child. But she swapped it. Be careful how you live. Your sin will find you out.
Amen.
In 1 Kings 3, 16 to 28, we also see a caring and compassionate mother. Stories cannot be told what some poor mothers have endured, have been through to protect, preserve, and provide for their children. What kind of mother are you? In Proverbs 31, we see King Lemuel's mother, a prophetic an industrious mother. She taught her son not to be a womanizer, a wine bibber, or drunkard, because this would impair his judgment and lead to forgetting and breaking God's law. She taught him not to pervert justice, to stand up for the cause of the poor and needy, and to seek to have a virtuous and godly woman as his wife. Oh, we need mothers who will give godly advice and counsel to their sons and daughters. Thank God for my mother. Thank God for my aunt. Thank God for my grandmother. They take time out to teach me.
Yes.
And their teachings, though they are not here,
yes.
Is in me.
Yes. Amen.
And the greatest gift you can give to any child is a spiritual or godly legacy.
Amen.
In Matthew 20, 20 to 23, we see an ambitious mother, Salome, Zebedee's wife, who wanted what was best for her two sons. She requested that James and John, she requested of Jesus that James and John, he should sit one at the right and one of his left in his kingdom. Some mothers want what is best for their children. But do you really care about others, mothers, children? Jesus told her what she was asking for is beyond her pay grade. Sometimes our wish, our plans, our goals for our children are not in keeping with God's will or God's word. So we need to go to God and seek guidance from his word. God, help me to guide my child in the way he should grow. So when he's old, he'll never depart from godly precepts, godly principle, godly lives, and godly example. Children live what they learn. As parents, we want what is best for our children. But we need to consult God and seek his guidance in ensuring that our best for them is in keeping with God's plans and purpose. In Mark 16, 21 to 29, we see an immoral mother, Herodias. She told her daughter to request of King Herod, the head of John the Baptist. Her marriage to Herod Antipas caused an outrage among the people, who saw it. It was a violation of the Jewish law because it was forbidden for a man to marry his brother's divorced wife. John the Baptist spoke out about this and was locked up in prison. So she had a beef with him and wanted him dead. So the opportunity came. Her daughter danced before the king and pleased the king. And the king said, "You can ask half of my kingdom, I'll give it." She went to her mother and said, "Mommy, what should I ask for?" Mommy didn't even think a second. The head of John the Baptist. I don't know what expression that poor child gave, but that was a gory request. You want the head of the man of God on a platter? Listen up. Children are listening. When the bad talk,
amen,
or bad mouth,
amen,
pastor,
amen,
pastor wife,
amen,
deacons,
amen,
deacon wife, amen, or deaconess, when we bad mouth another brother or a sister, amen, in Christ, when we chat them behind them back, children are listening, and they may not say much, but they are learning. And we need to understand that children live what they learn. Are you an immoral, gory mother? What are you saying to your children? We need to understand the society in which we live. Words have consequences, and they may not impact our lives, but they impact the lives of our children, our children's children, other people's children.
That's right.
I've heard many mothers said to their sons, "You're just like your papa. You're just like your father," and doesn't mean something good, you know. I've heard some mothers said to their daughter, "You're too worthless, buffoon, good for nothing. We grew up in a culture where it says stick and stone can break my bone, but unkind word cannot hurt me. That's a lie from the pit of hell. Because when the licks and the scar heal, the emotional pain, that's why there are many adults now in society who are suffering from pains from their childhood because of an unwise word, an unkind word, an out of place word, and they're breaking havoc in the adult life of that child. You see, we need to set a moral standard. We need to be people of morality. We cannot be immoral. It's very important what we see here. John the Baptist spoke out against her adulterous relationship, and she was mad with the man of God. Don't use your children as pawns or as means to enact vengeance against someone you have a beef with. We must influence and advise our children for good, not for evil. Amen. We can't be immoral and want them to be moral. Amen. The influence of a mother on her child or children cannot be overstated. In our own country, these United States of America, there are some mothers, no issue, call themselves daughters of the Confederate, who taught their children to hate black people. May God help their soul wherever it is. Doesn't mean because someone's skin color is darker than us, they are bad. And because ours are clearer than theirs, we are better. Man look on the outward appearance, but God looks on the heart. And we need to understand in the society in which we live, the power of love is stronger than the power of hate. A flash of match can put out the darkness in a room, and we are the light of the world. A city that is set upon a hill cannot be hid. Let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and come to glorify our Heavenly Father. We are living in a time when we see hatred and racism is rampant in this nation. And we need to take a stand and say, that's from the pit of hell. The word of God said, he that hated his brother is a murderer. And a murderer has not the life of God in him. Racism is not of God. Black should not hate white people. White people should not hate black people. And we should not hate brown people either. We are all God's creation. What a wonderful world this could be. Each man as my brother. Each man as my friend. Each man as my sister. Each man as my man. Humanity. My mother influenced me to love, not only in words, but in deed. She influenced me to love God and be a part of the church family. I saw and heard my mother pray. I saw and heard my mother read the Bible. I saw my mother attend church and give to church. What kind of mother are you? Are you setting a God example for children? Not only yours. In 1 Samuel chapter 1 and 2, we see Anna. And in 2 Timothy 1 verse 5, we see Eunice and Lois. Godly and prayerful mothers and grandmothers who take time out to teach their children to love God and to serve in the things of God. 1 Samuel chapters 1 and 2 and 2 Timothy 1:5 Eunice and Lois. You see, Samuel served in the tabernacle and grew up to be a mighty prophet and a servant of God. And Timothy served in the church and became a committed pastor and servant of God. Children live what they learn. We need to teach them the word of God and encourage them to be involved in the service of God. What kind of mother are you? As I wind down the sermon, have you found out who we are yet? Yes. Are you a distraught mother like Hagar? A deceptive mother like Rebecca? A disingenuous mother like the one who swapped her dead kid for the other mother's? A caring and compassionate mother who'd rather give over her child to the other than see it killed? Are you a prophetic and industrious mother like King Lemuel's, who prophesied in the life of her son and gave him guidance about women and the choice of a future mate, a godly woman, a virtuous woman? Are you an ambitious mother like Salome? She wanted the best for her children. What was her best in keeping with the will and plans of God for them? Are you an immoral mother like Herodias? Or a godly and prayerful mother like Anna and Eunice? You see, godly mothers bring their children to Jesus in person and in prayer. Godly mothers not only teach their children many things about life, they teach them the word of life.
Amen.
Godly mothers give their child or children godly advice and speak prophetically over their life. Amen. You are meant for something. God has a purpose and plan for your life. You're a leader, not a follower. You lead others in doing the right. You'll not follow them in doing the wrong. Godly mother exhibit care and compassion not only for their children but for the children of other mothers. Amen. If our children are to grow up to be strong in the Lord and spiritually mature, they cannot just spend time on academics and ignore the word of God. They ignore the word of God at their own peril. The word of God will help them make wise decisions later on in life and avoid the pitfall and mishaps other kids fall into. The story is told about a mother whose sole focus was on her son getting a good education. He read and studied many books, but did not have time to read the Bible. He was doing well academically, but eventually he fell ill and died. On the day of his funeral, while the casket was being lowered in the ground, she shook her head, and with a deep sigh, she said, "Look at the good education." What a difference her response would have been if she had invested in his spiritual welfare. There may be some parents here today who have misplaced priorities. It is okay for your sons and daughters, grandkids, to excel academically and have standing in society. But remember Jesus' word. What shall it profit the person if he gain the whole world and lose his soul? What can he give in exchange for his soul? Oh Lord, teach us to number our days, that we may apply our hearts to wisdom. As parents, we must come to realize that we cannot love and care for our child or children like God does. So we must seek His guidance for their lives. As children, we also need to realize that we cannot love our parents as God loves them. But God wants us to be obedient to them, show honor and respect, and follow their godly example. All of us need to know and understand how much God's love, how much God loves us. He formed us in our mother's womb. Psalm 139 said He saw our substance, being yet unformed. He guides us through the embryonic stage. He saw us birthed by our mom, either by natural means or a cesarean section. And He has been preserving our lives. And He said, I do not just want to be part of your mother's family. I want to be part of my family. I love you so much that I gave my son, that if you believe in him, you will not perish, but have everlasting life. I have a plan for you. Greater plans than your mother. Greater plans than your father. As a matter of fact, my son tell you, in my house there are many mansions. If it were not so, I'd have told you. He has gone to prepare a place for you. And if he goes, he'll come back to receive you. That where he is there, you may be also. This is a paradise. No more sickness. No more pain. No more schoolwork. No more study. No more bills. No more mortgage. No more rent.
Glory, hallelujah.
What a day. What a place. He said, if you trust me and give your heart to me and surrender, if you allow me to be in your life, in your heart, I'll make room for you in heaven.
Yes, amen.
I want you to be part of my family.
Yes.
I want to be your eternal father.
Yes.
I want you to live with me forever.
Amen.
And if you'd hear his voice today and not your heart, he will come into your life. And you will become a child of God.
Yes, amen.
He came unto his own. His own receive him not. But as many have received him, to them he gave the right,
yes,
the privilege,
yes, yes,
to become the sons of God.
Yes, hallelujah.
You can make that decision today by giving your life to Jesus.
Amen.
Mothers, don't underestimate the power of your prayer.
Mm-mm.
Don't underestimate the power of your counsel. Don't underestimate the power of your life. It's a book. Our children, other children, are reading the pages every day. And when they are ready to write their book about you, when they are ready to write their book about me, what kind of mother will they say you are?
Amen.
What kind of father will they say I am?
Amen.
What kind of parent will they say we are?
Amen.
What do you do when you have done all you can?
Amen.
Living a godly life before them, setting a godly example, but they choose a part that is not keeping with your godly life and principle. Just stand back.
Yes.
Just stand still.
Yes.
And continue to pray and see God does,
ooh,
his thing.
Hallelujah.
because he has begun a good work in you. We'll continue it until the day of Jesus Christ. And if he work out his will in you, by God, he can work out his will in them. And someday they will rise up and say, blessed be that mom. Blessed be that cup from which I suck. Blessed be that womb that gave birth to me on this Mother's Day.
Thank you, Jesus.
I want to say, raising children now and then, it's not easy. But with God in the vessel, you can smile at any storm. Do the best you can. And when you have done your best unhurt, not even angels in heaven can do better. Happy Mother's Day, Mother. May God crown your life with godliness, and he may favor you with a blessing. Darling on. Darling on. Let us hope and trust. Let us watch and pray and labor till the Master come. May God bless you. May he guide you. May he keep you. May he sustain you. May he give you the capacity not only to love your child, but to love other people's children. Listen to this song as it's played. It's about a mother's prayer. Continue to be a prayer warrior for God. Continue to lift up your eyes to the hills, from whence cometh your help. Your help cometh from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. Just listen. Stand still and let God do his thing. Happy Mother's Day, Mom.
To be